Happy AM.
Well, not exactly Rowan Roper today, at least not for the next 3 hours. Rowan Roper are off, I'm sure, contributing to the quick rebound of the economy, but two guys who have joined me here in the studio today are rolling up their sleeves and are going to have a lot to say about what direction the economy goes, particularly in the next 2 years. And that is Congressman-elect Joe Walsh from the 8th District and Congressman-elect Bobby Schilling from the 17th District. It's great to have both of you guys in studio. And we've been billing this in our planning sessions as the freshman hour. So you're not freshman to life, obviously, but you're freshman as it relates to coming into the House of Representatives. And I know that there's a lot of folks that are deeply appreciative of the philosophy and the attitude that you both took on as you made a decision to campaign for office. And if you're just joining us and you want to have a conversation, put in a call to 312-591-8900 or just come on the text 68683 and put in WLSAM, and the text will jump up here on a screen and we're going to get to as many as we can. But here's the first question to both of you. Joe, let's start with you. So you make a decision to run against a very successful incumbent who had represented the 8th District for the past 6 years, and nobody thought you could win, including me, including most folks that were in office and most folks that you came around. What is that like, sort of temperamentally? Where does the tenacity come within you to persevere, notwithstanding a lot of people that are just kind of thinking, oh, you know, courtesy calls and we're nice and stuff, but nobody thought you were going to win. You thought you were going to win the whole time. What's that like? Just kind of walk folks through that a little.
Yeah, Peter, and thanks for having us. At first, it can be tough. Probably my wife and our dog were the only other two that thought we had a shot at the beginning. But the interesting thing, and I don't know what Bobby will say, the interesting thing about my race is Melissa Bean was perceived to be a pretty tough incumbent. I never, from the very beginning, thought I was running against her. I was so incensed with the direction the country was taking, the government spending, that I wanted to run to stop that. Hmm. Now, she happened to be on the wrong side of that. But because I led with that and I said I'm angry with how much money we're spending, I mean, day after day, people joined us. So by the summertime, when we had thousands of volunteers, I knew we had something going. But up until you get that grassroots stuff going, it can be a lonely endeavor.
Yeah. Bobby, how about you? What was it like? So for the benefit of everybody that's listening that doesn't know these district numbers, Joe, your district is
the eighth
district, and that's McHenry County, parts of Lake County, some suburban Cook.
A little bit of Cook, yeah.
And then you go out west beyond that, don't you?
All the way west, about the eastern part of McHenry County and the western part of Lake County, a large chunk of Lake County.
Okay. Bobby, what is the 17th district like? It's almost impossible to describe, so I'm going to make you do it.
Yeah, it's probably one of the most gerrymandered districts in the United States of America. We go into Rock Island County, Macon County, Adams County, through several different cities that we have to go through to get over to other parts of the district, but it's definitely one of the most gerrymandered districts.
All right, so when you started coming around, as I described you after I'd met you a couple of times, I told folks Bobby Schilling is the only guy who hasn't figured out that he's supposed to lose this race. What was that like? You coming around? I remember you coming out to Washington, making the rounds, you getting in front of people, and same thing with Joe. All of a sudden, you had the benefit of Joe. Nobody thought Joe was going to win. You had the benefit of Labor Day is when you were starting to get kind of hot as it relates to the momentum of the campaign. But up until then, you were basically pressing your nose up against the glass looking in. What was that like for you?
You know, it didn't really bother me at all. You know, just to kind of give you an idea, one of my most favorite shows is The Cinderella Man, Seabiscuit. You know, those are shows that I watched all the time with my family. But, you know, I've been told several times through life that there's certain things that I can't do. And time and time, I just put my nose to the grindstone and just worked my tail off. And you know, we knew we could win it. We just needed the right storm. And I had a friend of mine from Moline, Illinois, that kept saying, you're going to need a perfect storm. And as we got closer and closer, he would continue to text me and say, hey, I see a lot of clouds forming. Mm. So just a lot of hard work. And the volunteer, the grassroots, just like Joe was talking about, the effort there was just unbelievable what came to happen there towards the end.
Well, and it's volunteers who have the impact to be very buoyant, right? I mean, you see people that are willing to support you based on what you believe in, and they're tenacious, they're willing to make the calls, they're willing to go the distance and physically do the work. And from a candidate's point of view, that's incredibly uplifting, isn't it? I mean, it's so encouraging.
It won the election for me. I'm often asked, Peter, what was it like not having the National Party come in at all? And I know folks love me to whack the party over the head, but I won't, because you know what an amazing climate this was. The party had the opportunity to get involved in so many races. That's an amazing gift. So we were forced to develop a real internal campaign and develop a real grassroots campaign, because that's all we had.
Yeah, that's the silver lining. I mean, so when you've got thousands of people literally that feel connected and invested in Congressman-elect Joe Walsh in the 8th District, that's a big deal. Okay, now rewind the tape. Take people back to you win, it's election night. Joe, your election night was still a little bit uncertain, mm-hmm. but you knew where it was going.
Yeah.
So you go out for orientation. You fly out, what was it, about 10 days, Sunday or so after the election. So you didn't go out the first week, you didn't go out the second week, but it was that next Sunday. You fly out to Reagan, and just reflect for folks and give them a little bit of a perspective about what you experienced that week. Bobby, let's start with you.
You know, it was an awesome experience. It was actually quite overwhelming, and the best way to describe the information that we took in is basically, it's like drinking water from a fire hose. But you know, the best experience that I had out there was the opportunity afforded to us just to sit down with other freshmen, like-minded people that basically, Peter, and we've talked about this a little bit, that the fight was brought to us, you know, and we weren't going to sit back and watch what was happening to this great nation, that all the veterans that ever fought and died and bled for this country, we were unwilling to sit back. And just the bonding that happened, and then also leaving, it was almost sad when we left that day, but knowing that we're going to get back together and we're going to bring the voice of the American people to Washington, D.C., and it's a good feeling, and I'm really actually quite excited about this.
Joe, how about you? What did you experience?
Peter, it was just so exciting to be there with such a large class. I mean, the city was abuzz. The two things I walked away from were an incredible sense of humility and a resolute sense of purpose. That first night, I think, Bobby, when we had dinner and we got off the bus, and it's a beautiful, clear, cold Washington night, and you look up at the whiteness of the Capitol, I mean, my heart stopped for a moment. That was unbelievable. But then the sense of purpose, everybody in the freshman class, and as we met you members, everybody knows why we were sent there.
Yeah.
And everybody knows what we've got to do these next 2 years, or we're coming back home.
When you guys were sort of making the rounds the past couple of weeks in Washington, I went up to Paul Ryan, who is going to be the next budget chairman, and I went up to him and said, hey, brother, your job just got a lot easier, because I said these folks that are coming in are ready to do some very heavy lifting as it relates to budgeting priorities and things that we have to do as a nation. You know, Mark Kirk, our next senator, was here a couple of minutes ago, and Mark was reflecting and commenting on the vulnerability that we have as a country if we don't get our fiscal house in order. The international ramifications, the security ramifications, and there is much more invested in us being wise than just sort of rubbing the nickels together, right? It is a foundation. A strong economy is a foundation for a lot of other things. So as you're moving forward and you're looking out over this landscape, what is the thing that you had no idea you were going to experience in a campaign that just was you didn't contemplate it at all? What was the thing, as you've talked to your brides and you've walked this journey, that you didn't see coming from a campaign point of view?
You know, there were several different small things, but you know, the big thing that I had no idea is that that I would get some support. The thing that was very nice, Peter, about the NRCC is basically they left me out there on my own to kind of build up and bring this thing up on my own. And once they saw some numbers coming through, then they came in and they say, hey, you know what, we're going to give you a little bit of a hand. But you know, when we got news that they were going to kick in and do some commercials, that was a huge lift for us, because we knew the race was very tight by all of the polling, and I think that that had a great deal to do with pushing us over the top. You know, some of the commercials that were run, it was discouraging, you know, because we were trying to stay to the issues, and the other side was going more on the personal attacks. You know, I was sending jobs overseas from my pizzeria in Moline, Illinois. So
didn't know you had that kind of power.
Yeah, myself either. So,
Joe, how about you?
You know, I was most surprised at how large the movement is out there at folks who are upset. I got branded a Tea Party conservative candidate, and I'd always say that this movement has nothing to do with party. There was a line I'd always use where I'd say, this is the year you take your party affiliation, you throw it out your window. So many independents, and I know, Bobby, you experienced this too, independents and Democrats throughout the campaign came up to me. Some with fingers in my chest saying, I'm with you.
Yeah.
But some Democrats would whisper and say, you're right. This spending's got to be controlled. I was amazed at how it crossed party lines.
I think it's interesting, just the sense of civic responsibility that people are assuming once again. I had one friend that told me, he said, Peter, I used to be able to afford not to care who was in Congress. And he said, literally, I could afford not to care. Now I can't afford it. Now I have to be aware of the worldview of these people that we're sending to Washington, D.C., because of their impact on my business. And I'm sure that that's the same thing that you were hearing consistently throughout the campaign, and that there were people that were all of a sudden, their heads were in this game like never before.
Man, Peter, I'd be a rich man if I had a nickel for every person that came up to me and said, I've never been involved in politics until right now.
Right.
It was amazing.
As I've described some of you guys to other people who haven't had the chance to meet you, I said this class was sort of figuratively minding their own business at their kitchen table. And the fight came knocking on their front door and they said, step outside. And you whooped them outside in the street. And now you've got this responsibility. It's kind of like the Robert Redford character at the end of The Candidate, where he turns to Peter Boyle and says, what do we do now? Well, you're in it, man. And so but I think that there's a lot of expectations, but I don't think that they're false expectations, so long as that there's no hubris, no triumphalism. You know what I mean? This is a season of actually reflecting very, very deeply on the direction that our country is going, and you're going to be inextricably linked to our country's prosperity. And I think people are going to reflect back, and the election of 2012 will have been a seminal election where really substantive issues were on the were on the block. So if you're just joining us, you're listening to Representatives-elect Joe Walsh from the 8th District and Bobby Schilling from the 17th District. And I'm Congressman Peter Roskam in for Rowan Roper. If you want to join in the conversation, just jump on the call, 312-591-8900. And both these guys are battle-tested, and believe me, there's nothing that you can pitch at them that they haven't heard already, probably millions of dollars spent against them in the course of campaign. So they're going to be with us all the way through this this next hour. But I think moving forward, just quickly before we have to take a break, as what word of encouragement would you give to a candidate who is thinking about making a race for office, let's say Congress or whatever it happens to be? Bobby, what advice would you give to somebody?
You know, I would tell folks out there is, look, we live in the greatest country in the world, where a guy with 10 kids that's running a pizzeria in Moline, Illinois can you know, step out of the square, out of my comfort zone, and decide that, hey, you know what, I'm not going to sit back and take it anymore and go in and make a run for U.S. Congress and get the thing done. You know, what an awesome land we live in. And that's the thing I kept telling people, Peter, is that what we are doing is, this isn't my seat. This is the people's seat. We'll take the voice of the people to walk.